You found a different.
I don't wanna.
Did I give you my card?
Yes.
Okay, good, so you got it.
Because it's not my department, I said it's not helpful, sir.
I think we're gonna go ahead and get your.
All right, good morning, everyone. Thanks for being here. Most of you know, I think by this point, I'm Holly Mannheimer, and I run the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. First of all, thanks to the Atlanta Journal-Constitution for hosting us this morning, and I know they're gonna say a few words of welcome. Most of you know House Bill 397, which is the first major revamp to the open government laws in about a decade since 1999 passed. And the most interesting, or one of the most interesting things about it, was that it was a bill that became into law effective the day it passed, or the day it was signed by the governor, which was April 17th. Normally, bills in Georgia become effective July 1st following the legislative session. So we could talk about whether that means this is really important or not. I'm not sure that that's relevant. The point is, though, we've got a new set of open government laws on the books right now. They've been in effect for a few months now. We're seeing how they work. We're learning the ramifications, hopefully mostly good, some bad. But we thought this program was worthwhile doing, simply to talk us through, simply to answer questions about what is new. And so, as you know, we have 1 hour, a good generous hour today on the Open Records Act and the changes to that, and then we'll do 1 hour, generous hour at that on the Open Meetings Act. I know both of the speakers welcome all the questions that you've got, so that makes us think through the changes as well. As most of you know, I go around the state teaching this. I was in Macon last week, and I'm still being stumped by some of the new questions. How's this gonna work, Holly? And I said, I don't know. We'll need a lawsuit. We don't have one yet, but we will have one. So there's gonna be a lot to shake out and see, but again, the more we know, as we all go out and ask for records and try to get into meetings, we'll be educating those public agencies also that are trying to withhold documents or bar us from meetings. Couple of things about the materials. That red book off to the left on the table, it has not been rewritten. That's my first project after this training sessions get through. Citizen's Guide to Open Government, we've got a bunch of them. I'm gonna try to get it done and distributed maybe early 2013 to reflect the changes of the laws. We've got some other publications as well, but that's probably the first one that we will rewrite. One of the things I'd like to ask you to think about doing for the First Amendment Foundation is writing me, not me personally, but the First Amendment Foundation, a check of $5, $10, $25 if you felt like it. Again, we exist on the generosity of folks and organizations like the Atlanta Journal-Constitution and everybody. It's a tiny budget, half of me, I am the budget. So to get our materials published, to get this knowledge out there, if you think about a $25 check, believe it or not, that helps a lot. So think about something if you can. Regardless, I don't know that there are very many prefatory remarks more than that. I think what we'll do, we're gonna have our generous host say hello, and then I think we may flip our order and start with open meetings today.
I want you to know that I actually brought, I want to put pressure on you guys, but I actually brought a blank check and I'm gonna fill it out here before I leave.
Did you see me in the background?
I'm Kevin Riley, editor of the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, so I just wanted to welcome you here and say a couple things, the most important of which is anyone involved in any way with the First Amendment Foundation should be sort of basking in the glow of having gotten this new law passed. I talk about it all the time internally with our folks, especially our non-journalists, on whom sometimes, you know, these sorts of things aren't as apparent. But I think it's historic, and, you know, I've told these guys this, and, you know, state legislatures around the country, they're not improving open records laws generally. They're busy going in the other direction. And, you know, I came here from Ohio, and frankly, I don't think we would have even tried, let alone pulled it off there, even with 8 pretty substantial newspapers in that state that banded together on a lot of things. So I think that you should not just enjoy that, but be awful proud of it. And I think that it sets Georgia up to be, you know, one of the great states in the union, as it should be, given its size and its economy, because it gives us a chance to be much better governed than I think we may have been to this point. And then the other thing we try to never forget, and I always emphasize, is, you know, the newspaper has a lot of resources, and we, of course, support the First Amendment Foundation. But we also can kind of go to war with public officials who decide they know better than citizens, or they have a better idea of what citizens ought to be, you know, allowed to know. And then Tom, our attorney from Thomas, joins us in those fights, actually leads us in those fights usually. But we never forget that what we're really doing is representing citizens. Because these records, while, you know, they obviously play a role in our business and in what we do, in the end, the fight's about making sure citizens have access to information that they should have. And the reason I think that's important, besides, you know, it's what the framers of the Constitution intended, but is this. It's very easy for someone in the legislature or in public office to demonize the media. You know, that's really, entire campaigns operate that way now. Just blame the media for everything, make up things and pretend the media aren't reporting what they should, all of that. But it's very hard for them to demonize a citizen who wants to find out about what's going on in their community or in their schools or with their children or with people who are spending their tax dollars. So I hope that inspires you in your work and in the session today, because I think that in the end, you know, that is the work of the First Amendment Foundation. That's why we support it, because if everyday citizens, if the average, all of us average people don't care about these things, then no one will. And we'll wake up one day in this country and the state could be a very different place. So I applaud you for making your way here this morning through traffic and everything that it's like to get anywhere in Metro Atlanta on a typical morning. So thanks, and I hope you have a good day. I'm hoping to stop back later. I am going to walk away with a bagel, but not before I fill out my check. So thank you.
Just a little housekeeping, and then Tom will get started and we'll go straight on through. There are bagels and coffee in the back. Please help yourself. The restrooms are out here. If you have questions, you can interrupt, but we might say, oh, that's coming up in the next segment, so we might put you off if you want to. Pretty quick. The other thing, I don't think Holly mentioned this, but this presentation is on the First Amendment Foundation site, and so if you want to access it at a later date, there's one slide in here that's not on the one there, and we'll update it and get it out. And we can also send it out as a follow-up. This is Tom Clyde, our attorney from Dallas, and a member of the First Amendment Foundation Board. And he's going to start.
Hello, everybody. Number one, I'm sorry for being late this morning. You guys did much better with the traffic than I did. What we're going to do first is take a look at changes to the open records. And to give you a sense of the way this PowerPoint works, basically, existing law is represented in white on these slides, and the changes is represented in gold. The changes are represented in gold. The red book that many of you picked up and we are offering and making available is the old law. And so what you'll be seeing in gold are the changes from the old law. We will eventually be creating a new red book that will have the text of the new law and a synopsis of the changes of the new law. This PowerPoint, as Sean mentioned, is on the Georgia First Amendment Foundation website. So the first thing I want to touch on is what is covered by the Open Records Act. As Kevin mentioned, we have a very strong Open Records Act. That was true before. It is even more true today. And one of the places where it is strongest is in terms of the scope of the records that it reaches. It really reaches virtually any conceivable document in any form that has been received or maintained, received and maintained by the government. It's either if it's prepared by the government or if it was received by the government, it's subject at a threshold level to the Open Records Act. That is true of electronic records, records received by computer or by cell phone or by any other electronic means. The new Open Records Act continues that scope and even makes it a little stronger. It spells out very clearly that electronic records, including data and email, are covered by the law. So who is subject to the Open Records Act? That's, again, a strength of our Open Records Act. It reaches all state and local agencies in really any form they take. One of the things the current law added was the word offices. I'm not sure exactly what drove that, but it makes even clearer that it's reaching virtually any form of government. One of the things, there are certain areas that it doesn't reach. The most notable exception is the General Assembly itself. It doesn't reach, yes, they passed a law that gives access to virtually all other aspects of government, but not the General Assembly itself. The General Assembly has certain rules about their own records, but it's not itself covered by the Open Records Act. In addition to what we think of as traditional government, the Open Records Act also reaches some areas that are unusual, frankly, for a freedom of information law at the state level. It reaches nonprofits that receive a third of their funds from taxpayers. That used to include, I think, the word substantial, and now it's spelled out in the law what that means. So even if a nonprofit is only receiving a third of its funds from a direct allocation of taxpayer money, that will subject them to the Open Records Act. The same is true for certain associations of counties and municipalities. And this is one of the most important, this final line, is one of the most important and unusual aspects of our Open Records Act. It also reaches the records of a private person or entity that is performing a service or function on behalf of an agency. That was language that was added to the Open Records Act in the very late 90s. It actually significantly expands the scope of the organizations that the that government can reach. Government is increasingly delegating its responsibility to private organizations. That's a process that's occurred over time. It's a process that I would expect to continue. Corporations are sometimes very effective at carrying out certain governmental functions or performing a service for function. But what this means is those private organizations, whether it's a private company or a private individual, their records are subject to the Open Records Act to the extent they are performing a service or function for the government.
And that is the records relating to that service, right?
Exactly. So when IBM is providing a service to a county, let's say providing some computer services, the computer services that it's providing relating to that function, not all of IBM's records become open to the Open Records Act, but the records that it gets from performing that service, that it generates in performing that service, are subject to the Open Records Act. So we're going to now touch a little bit. So one of the things I want to mention, obviously we'll take questions at the end, but also don't hesitate to raise your hand if you have questions at any point in this presentation. If there's things that I don't want the PowerPoint to override a discussion. If you have questions, just jump right in and we'll take those at any time. We're going to take a look a little bit at the process for Open Records Act requests, because that has changed in some meaningful ways. But I don't think it's fundamentally changed what I hope is the speed with which the Open Records Act works. So how do you make an Open Records Act? Do you have to do it in writing, or can you make a oral Open Records Act? The Open Records Act, the new law, actually basically struggled with that issue. And the ultimate conclusion was that you can make either an Open Records Act request in writing or verbally. You can make a verbal Open Records Act request, saying, hey, I'd just like that record pursuant to the Open Records Act. But if you just make it verbally, you can't invoke the enforcement mechanisms of the act, frankly, the penalties in the act. In other words, one of the things we're going to touch upon is the fact that there are now increased penalties for an agency if it does not comply with the Open Records Act. That was a source of significant concern to the organizations that basically represent municipalities and the state agencies. They were worried that they would end up being fined for a verbal Open Records Act request that they lost track of in the system or never really understood. And so the resolution of that is if you want to invoke the enforcement mechanisms, you're going to have to reduce it to writing at some point. So a written request is required for enforcement. Who does that written request go to? Under the old law, the written request would go to the custodian of records. In a lot of occasions, that was difficult to figure out exactly who is the custodian of the records. From an outsider's point of view, you don't really know who's keeping their records, and yet you're supposed to be sending it to the custodian. The new law, I hope, makes that clear in a couple of ways. Number one, an agency can, and I think over time a fair amount of agencies will, designate an Open Records Act custodian for the agency. And if they do that, they make that decision saying, this is the person who will receive Open Records Act requests for us. They have to publicize that person's name in a lot of different ways. They have to put it on their website. If you call them up, they have to tell you who that custodian is. So they've got to be basically constantly informing the public of who our Open Records Act custodian is. They don't have to choose a custodian. If they don't choose a custodian, basically the new act makes clear that senior most officials in the agency receive Open Records Act. They can receive Open Records Act. And that way it's going to be up to them to actually track down, well, who's on whose shelf is that record? In whose computer is that record? Mm-hmm.
I'm a little confused on that because I have submitted open records requests and have been told, oh, written back within 3 days. Those records are not in my possession. And then I said, okay, then who do I go to? And they said, well, basically, I end up writing like 5-6 different open records to different departments, and all of them send me in circles saying they don't have the documents. I said, well, then somebody needs to tell me who has them, or who do I go to that can point me in the right direction. So when a private citizen finds themselves in that position, I know the law says they're not supposed to do this, but the law is not in that office when they're doing it to us.
Sure. So let's talk about that, because there's two possible issues there. Number one, that experience that you had under the old law was common and kind of ingrained into the governmental system. And so this law was passed very early this year, took effect very early this year, but frankly, the government agencies they're still in their early stages of beginning to figure it out. And so I think what you are likely seeing is people that aren't even aware of the language of the law on custodian has changed. A lot of government agencies are not, they knew that a new Open Records Act law had passed. They know it's very similar to the old Open Records Act law. They don't really know the differences. And this is one of the differences. One of the things that's worthwhile is basically to try and find, is to quote this section of the law. Because I do think it does read very differently than the old law. And there's also, of course, the possibility that they're just intentionally giving you the runaround because nobody's there to enforce it. And so that's a situation where one of the things we do encourage you to do, the Attorney General has an open government mediation program, and frequently they can be helpful in making an agency understand that this citizen does have a place to go to try and get the law enforced. And that'll help their office making a telephone call can frequently help get more practical cooperation. So the next step is the records. So let's say that you've submitted a written request. Do they have the records? How quickly do they have to produce the records? The records have to be produced for inspection within a reasonable amount of time, not to exceed 3 days. That is exactly the same rule that applied under the old law. If the records are available, they have to produce them within 3 days. What is a reasonable amount of time? There will be certain times where you certainly have the argument that it is not reasonable to wait all 3 days if I'm asking for a simple, straightforward document. The idea behind the 3 days is that some documents are not straightforward. Some documents are going to have exempt information in them, and at a minimum, the government agency may need 3 days to try and evaluate whether there's information that is in them is exempt. What happens if some of the information is available, but other information is not? You're asking for records that are in, for example, off-site storage, or otherwise in use in a way that the government agency can't get access to them. If some, but not all of the records are available within 3 days, the agency is now supposed to undertake a rolling production. That's a difference from the old law. In other words, they're not supposed to simply hold all the records back until they get them all together and then give them to you. They're supposed to provide the records that they have available as soon as they have them available. If records are unavailable within that 3-day period, the agency also has an obligation. It has to basically, number one, describe the records and identify when they're going to be produced. So if they can't accomplish it in 3 days because they're unavailable, they describe them, they tell you when they're going to be produced, and the new law makes clear this new date for production, even if it's outside the 3 days, has to be as soon as practical, as practicable. There are certain agencies that had a history of saying, all right, we can't do it in 3 days, so it's going to be 3 weeks before you get your record, and giving you a date very far into the future. Now there's an obligation to show that they're operating as quickly as possible under the circumstances.
So if that doesn't work out, you call the Attorney General's office.
So the Attorney General's Open Government Mediation Program, exactly. And if you go to the Attorney General's website, there is a link there and contact information for their Open Government Program.
Maybe I'll mention it later, but. And this was produced. This grant book was produced by the
by the First
Attorney
Amendment
General?
Foundation and the First Amendment Foundation. And as I mentioned, we're redoing it. I'm hoping to update it by the end of the year. But essentially, Tom and
That's
I.
By the end of the year, we're almost near the end of the year.
Well,
okay. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, it's out of date, but. Yeah, again, okay. One could take the position that not that much has changed, so some people still like to have it around.
Let me give y'all one tip for getting help faster if you can. The Attorney General is a little overwhelmed by mediation program too. If you don't get a response within 3 days, write back the people and copy the Attorney General on your email.
Right.
And that will often shake things loose without you having to get on the phone with the Attorney General's office.
Oh, okay.
Just make sure if you're doing email correspondence or written correspondence, put a CC line to the Attorney General's Open Government Mediation Program, and sometimes that helps shake things loose in a way that maybe you don't have to wait for the program to actually kick in.
Although I have to say, I sent five emails to Stephen Ritter at the Attorney General's office begging for help, and he didn't reply to a single one of them. where I begged for him to help. We're done, he's violating laws. And I was like, really? So what do I do now? I can't even get them to reply to my emails.
Okay, so let's talk about like self-help. What are the most effective things? Number one, I always encourage, if somebody's not engaging on an Open Records Act request, start copying their boss and their boss and their boss. Practical reality is we are all uncomfortable about having our own bosses informed about friction that we're creating with it. And that's true for most government officials. They don't like having it kicked upstairs. So I mean, one of the tools that email makes pretty easily is you can keep, if you can figure out who they report to, you can keep marching up. The point that Sean made is an excellent one. The 3-day time limit is under the old law and now under the new law, it is perilous for a government agency to ignore that 3-day time limit. And what I mean by that is not necessarily the production of the records, but if you've got no response, nothing in writing, no acknowledgement, nothing, no explanation at all, that is a significant mistake by a public agency, because at that point, they really have no defense to the penalty provisions that we're going to talk about. And so if the other thing, in addition to copying their boss, I would really encourage you to try and copy the attorney that represents that agency. And that can be difficult to find, but if you search for a little bit, frequently you can find that out. Because the attorneys for the agency are going to recognize, like, whoa, we didn't even respond to this person in 3 days. We are already in a bad position. And so frequently they will help engage and get the process moving.
I was going to say, I probably send hundreds of open records a month. The City of Atlanta Police, for example, is famous for just saying it'll be 4 to 6 weeks and they'll get back with you. And I already have a standard letter drawn up for the provisions for the penalties. So as soon as I don't hear from them within the 3 days, I go ahead and send the letter and already have one on my computer that says, you know, you're now in violation of the thing. And usually I pushed back with the City of Atlanta PD about 2 months ago and they produced them as soon as I sent the letter. And usually, not always, but I'm right. Just saying, it's good to already have that letter drafted and just hit send to me.
I think that's true. And I do think that penalty provisions are worth reminding people, because they do. I do think that will have an impact. And then you had a question too.
I deal with Fulton County government and I'm not sure. However, I also deal with the attorney. Their response has been, within the 3 days, to write something that says, we're going to get it done, and they don't. I mean, it's going down to another department, it's going to go around somewhere, and you might do something if you continue to, I continue to bother them maybe 3 months later. So how strict is the 3-day limitation? I mean, is the 3-day limitation, if you get any kind of response, because that's what I get, is sort of a nonsensical response, but it is a response. We heard you. We know you want it, and that's about it. So is the 3-day to produce some document in recognition or produce what I ask for?
So it kind of depends what you ask for. In other words, if you're asking for a huge volume of records, or in records that are very difficult to find, are very are old or sort of in a difficult place for the government to lay hands on, then I do not think the court is going to expect the agency to produce the records in 3 days. But you are expected to get a response, and the law is very clear. You're expected to get a description of the records, which I have to say is logically a little odd if they're having a difficulty finding the records, but yet they have to describe them. I think courts may give some latitude to agencies in that area, but I do think this is going to be a big component. They're supposed to provide a timeline. So what is not satisfactory, and what I don't think a court would ever find satisfactory, is we're working on it and we'll get to it. Like, that's not a timeline. And that, I do think the courts, the thing that has set off the courts is when you don't even get an acknowledgement within 3 days, and my expectation is if that acknowledgement is utterly ignored in this timeline, I guess that too will create a problem.
One other self-help thing, and I think a lot of you in this room have done this, a lot of people CC the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, and while I can't necessarily write after you, it always, I think, always helps that somebody, the agency knows somebody else is looking over their shoulder. It's not just you. So just somebody else to slap on the bottom, and I just keep a file of the records request. But it's another thing to add, another person to add to the bottom of your letter.
And I'll add, don't send hundreds of them a month to us if that's what you're doing, but we're happy to hear from, you know, the reporter who covers that agency is happy to know if you have newsworthy stuff and you're not getting a response. I just wanted to add to what you said. This three-day thing, biggest change we've seen by far with the new law. We used to get the 3 days. We got your response, you know, we got your request. Under the old law, we got your request, we acknowledge it, we'll get back to you. Now they have to get back to you with something substantive within 3 days. And they do, and they know it. I mean, we've seen APD and others have said, oh, the change is huge. We've really got to go search them out now and give you an answer. So we're just getting a lot better response.
Mm-hmm.
I have two related questions. First, some written request. If they say, we never received the records. So my question is, does email come with the records? Or has anybody send a letter in the mail and they say they never, and the burden of proof is on whom? So that's the written request. And the second is the 3-day limitation. Citizens are not always in a position to know how difficult it might be to track down the records. So when they tell us that we need more time, it's a large volume. Is there anything that we can do
so,
to check?
Sure. Let me sort of touch on first of the first of those. Can you send your request by email? You can send your request by email if the agency is using email. Obviously, for all of the agencies in the Atlanta metropolitan area, and really for most agencies across the state. Yeah, they're going to be using email, but there is going to be some very small one county commissioners commissioner counties that may not use email. But that so generally email is perfectly fine way to send an Open Records Act request. The second question of how do we evaluate whether something is hard to obtain or asking for a large volume of records. One of the things I really encourage, absolutely, and I know this is more difficult at the citizen level, is trying to get a dialogue going with the agency, trying to have a conversation with the agency so that you are getting a back and forth about this is what you've asked for. Frequently, the agency is going to say, okay, we understand this is what you've asked for. That is actually a huge volume of records. But we have this document that will give you a more precise answer. In other words, I do encourage back and forth because a lot of times the information you need is fairly discreet. The information you are looking for is very fairly discreet. But the amount of records they have that are potentially responsive to the subject you've asked for is very broad. And so, having that conversation helps avoid them having to do unnecessary work, you having to pay for unnecessary work, because we're going to go over whether they're allowed to charge for certain costs they incur. And frequently, will allow the agency to frankly cut more quickly to the actual information that you're trying to get. And I know, I absolutely know, a lot of agencies will not engage in a discussion. They don't want to have a discussion, and I think that's unfortunate. I tell the same thing when I'm speaking to government agencies that are, you know, trying to figure out. But if you can get that discussion, I really encourage a telephone call, because frequently that makes life easier both for the agency and for you in getting access to the information. And so I hear you that it's hard for a citizen to evaluate how hard the response is, but if you can get a dialogue going, that's the best way to try and get through it. So
So this, I'm gonna just touch on quickly, I don't think this involves that many of you. If you are making an open records request in litigation, in other words, you're in active litigation with an agency and you're using the Open Records Act request almost as a form of discovery, like sending a subpoena, then the new law requires that all the counsel involved in that case be copied. So let's touch on costs, because that's a big issue. It's always been a big issue. It will continue to be a big issue. But there are some slight changes, both, what they cut basically both ways. So as under the old law, a government agency may impose a fee on the requester of a reasonable charge for search, retrieval, copying, and production. What the new law also adds is it enables an agency to charge for redaction. So what is redaction? Redaction is the process that an agency goes through to take out exempt information in a document that you've requested. For example, if somebody's social security number appears in that document, government agency can and should actually redact, black out that social security number before it's produced. It was unclear under the old law what charges they could pass along to the requester in connection with that. The new law makes clear they are allowed to charge for redaction, but they're only, all these search, retrieval, copying, production, redaction, all should take place at what is the prorated hourly salary of the lowest paid qualified employee. So what does that mean? The person who's capable of doing that work, the lowest paid hourly employee capable of doing that work, basically broken into the amount of time it takes that person or another person to do it. But that's the amount they're allowed to charge. One thing to be aware of, and this is an important one because I think agencies have tried to do it in the past and will continue to try to do it. Under the old law, it was clear they cannot charge for attorney time, for the time, the legal fees they incur having an attorney review records to determine whether they are subject to redaction. Not the physical process of redacting, but having attorneys decide, no, that under this portion of the law, that shouldn't be produced. Under the old law, they could not charge for the attorney time. Under the new law, they cannot charge for the attorney time. There was actually a draft, one of the versions of the bill included attorney time. There was uproar in response to that, and so the sponsor and the attorney general, the two people that really navigated the law through the General Assembly, removed that term, the attorneys, from the law. So that in combination with the past Court of Appeals decision should make very clear, you can't be charging for attorney time. So they can charge for the prorated hourly salary for the lowest paid qualified employee capable of doing the work. They can also charge for copying. If they're making paper copies for you, not electronic copies, but they're making paper copies, they can also charge. That changed under the new law in, I think, a very helpful way. The agencies used to be permitted to charge up to 25 cents a page. Virtually every agency did charge up the full 25 cents a page. If you were asking for 1,000 records, that is a big cost, and it's pretty easy for 1,000 pages to be end up, a government agency to end up with 1,000 responsive pages. So that was a big cost. The new, it has been now brought down to 10 cents a page, which is closer to the actual cost of copying in the modern era, but hopefully that will be a big cost savings to citizens and media across the entire spectrum of the state. So what if you're not getting a normal piece of 8.5 by 11 piece of paper? Or you're getting it on a thumb drive, for example. Then the agency should be charging the actual cost of that media. So if the price of the thumb drive, but also if you're getting a map or something, you're getting something that's very unusual, and there may be significantly higher copying costs for different types of documents. And in that situation, they are not limited to 10 cents per page.
Question?
Yeah.
Are there specific written guidelines for what can and what cannot be redacted? There's always a suspicion that you'll receive a document and what you're looking for will probably be redacted.
Right, so there's more than 40 exceptions to the Open Records Act in the new law, and we'll take a look at some of the most significant ones. There's other exceptions, unfortunately, spread around the Georgia Code, which is more than 40 volumes. So unfortunately, there is a large number of exceptions to the Open Records Law. But when something is redacted or not given to you under one of those exceptions, the agency is in that 3-day time period required to specify exactly the legal statute that authorized them not to produce it. So you should get an actual explanation of these are the things that these records have been redacted to remove the following items. So you should get a list of what led to that.
Some question for you. We have issues trying to determine at what point is the cost incurred on the person requesting documents. For example, say if you're sending a request to Fulton County, it's regarding emails between two people.
Right.
And you want to be able to actually look through that huge volume of documents and then find the documents you want and then be charged for those copies. And just trying to figure out, like say if we request, you know, documents between two people, the government comes back and says, okay, there's $2,000 in cost. But out of all those huge documents, you really only want a portion of them, and you only want to go through, you know, those documents and determine what you want.
Right.
So just trying to figure out at what point is the cost incurred on the person requesting the documents?
So you don't incur cost until you approve an estimate. But that they can start incurring costs as soon as they begin this process. In other words, search, retrieval, redaction, copying, and production. So let's talk a little bit about a request for email between two people. Unfortunately, the search component of that request could be reasonably expensive unless you're really narrowing down the scope of what you're asking for. So searching email between two people basically involves getting a technical person who's involved in that email. If you're asking for a big time period, that's going to involve a technical person who's in charge of operating the email system to basically pull all the email that was exchanged by those two people. That search, so unfortunately in that situation, the agency can charge the cost of that person having to conduct that search. And so particularly when you're making an email request, the more precision you can provide, the better. Because the biggest problem with email is it tends to have a high cost connected with it. But if you are saying, hey, I believe Tom Clyde at Fulton County and Sean McIntosh on the county commission exchanged emails on October 29th. I just want to see their emails from the 29th. There shouldn't be that significant a search cost. That can just be done basically manually. Like that, you don't need to run a search field through their email system. And so then the search cost should run considerably lower. So the more precision you can provide around the people and the dates, and if possible even what, you know, what the topic is, that helps a great deal.
But typically in our field of work, we really don't know specific dates. We know what we're looking for.
Right.
But we are hesitant to have them cherry pick what they want to give to us.
Right.
But from what you're saying, say we say go with the email scenario, email between two people, they could charge us for that search.
Right.
Even if we decide, okay, you know, it's $2,000, we don't want to pay for it, you know.
Right.
Technically, they could charge us for that search time. Even if we decide we don't want to come down and review them and give them those documents copies. Is that what you're saying?
Right. In other words, so like. Yes. Let's say you say, I'd like to see all the email that was exchanged between Tom Fly and Sean McIntosh for a month. And then I'll come down and inspect it, and I'll ask for copies of what I want. It is not the case. It is legitimate for an agency to say, all right, but you're going to
we're going to give you an estimate on the search costs, and you're going to have to pay that as part of the cost that you'll incur, even though you're only going to be copying a few pages. And so that's, email is a wonderful thing, but it is certainly possible for an agency to search large periods of time and pull up email exchange between two people, but the hard part is that it is reasonable for them to have search costs connected with that.
Mm-hmm. I'm wondering if Chris Mega Foundation or others involved in talking about this new legislation are worried about people being priced out of open records requests, because it seems like a good strategy for like the City of Atlanta or a lot more high profile state organizations to do business with more expensive attorneys. So even if you do the lowest paid qualified employee, you know, some of these large, you know, law firms that do a lot of business with, say, the City of Atlanta or the governor, like their lowest paid employee is still a lot more expensive than what most people could reasonably expect.
Sure. I want to be perfectly clear. Lowest paid qualified employee should never be an attorney. It should never be an attorney at a law firm. It should never be an attorney inside, and that's an employee of an agency. In other words, that is the legal costs that the agencies are required to bear and is outside the scope of the Open Records Act charges. Lowest paid qualified employee, what you're really doing, what you should be being paid there is a clerk who is conducting the redaction, literally blacking out the parts that are that should be blacked out. And I don't mean to say that you necessarily have to do it in magic marker, because frankly it's a lot more efficient to do it in different ways. And now frankly PDF allows you to sort of remove or obscure portions of PDFs. But it should be that person's time, the person who's physically carrying out the physical labor of doing it out. The legal cost, you know, City of Atlanta can hire whatever attorneys they want, even if it's a small, even if it's a large, expensive firm. That legal cost is something that the city has to bear, that shouldn't be being passed along to the requester. So it shouldn't, I do worry a lot about costs being used to intimidate Open Records Act requests, and frankly, the media sees that, individuals see that, it's a big problem. I do think the new act marginally improves that, but it's a problem that we're gonna continue to have.
Is there any exception or any way that a documents that you request for a search and retrieval that you can review before redaction?
Absolutely. So that's absolutely the case. If you can inspect documents before redaction. You can't inspect them before redaction, but you can inspect them before copying. But let me go back to your question. Can you inspect them before redaction? No.
There's no exceptions?
No.
Attorneys, private investigators, police officers cannot see a document before it's redacted?
Well, some of those, particularly the police officers, are actually within the umbrella of government. So basically the Open Records Act is trying to draw a line between government agencies that are within, individuals that are within government agencies and individuals that are without government agencies. And the redactions are generally, the exceptions to the Open Records Act are generally areas where the General Assembly and the governor have agreed that this information, if disclosed to the public, could cause some harm. And so the idea is it's redacted before it's released to the public. And so allowing you to see that what is going to be redacted before it's redacted would defeat the purpose of those exceptions. But a police officer, somebody involved in a police agency, could see a great deal more. Basically, it's there are some rules that control that, but basically police agencies can share police records with each other. And so they get to see information prior to the redaction.
If in the instance of a redaction, are there statutes that enumerate what redactions can be taken? And when you get that report, let's say you get a page with 15 different sections that have been redacted, does each report show the reason for each redaction?
You should get a listing of all of the statutes that supported the redactions that took place in your records. So you should get an itemization, absolutely, an itemization of based on these statutes, this information was removed from the records that you've requested. I'm going to jump to the GBI agent right in front of you. And I'm also going to compliment GBI because I've been doing this 20 years. Consistently for 20 years, the Georgia Bureau of Investigation has been by far the best agency in the state of Georgia for complying with Open Records Act requests and taking the process seriously from the beginning to the end. So I am not surprised that there are two GBI agents with us today. But they have an outstanding record in terms of really paying attention to this process. It doesn't mean we all always agree, but they pay attention to it.
I just want to
no
jump
further
in. I want to jump in. Typically what they give us is, you know, what's been redacted is social security numbers, birthdays, mother's maiden name. They don't go through the document and mark, this is where the mother's maiden name was, this is where, you know, they don't do that. They'll give you a generic summary of what's redacted. You can almost always tell, but they don't go through and mark each item and say this item was redacted under this exemption.
So it may have been 9 redactions, but only like 3
exemptions. Quote. Right. If they're, right, exactly.
Going back to her email question, if she had sent me this request for emails between 2 supervisors or whatever, and I gave her the estimate for the search, she comes down and goes through all the records, what she's looking for is not there. Do I charge her for the search still?
I think it is legitimate for the agency to still charge for the search. In other words, I do think that's the part where I really encourage dialogue between the requester and the agency, because that is a moment where nobody is happy. The agency's not really happy to be passing along the bill. The requester's not be happy to getting that bill. And so trying to have a dialogue so that everybody knows really what everybody's after is key to trying to prevent that.
Just as a follow-up to the email question, it seems like one of the complexities that I have seen over and over again is public officials or agency officials using their private emails to conduct public business. Is that addressed either in this new bill at all? Because there's all kinds of stuff. I mean, you might be looking for a particular thing. They might be looking at the official emails. But if you had access to other email accounts, it might tell an entirely different story.
So that's a very good point and a very big problem. Government officials increasingly use their private email, and actually, I am not faulting government officials from having a private email. I do think government officials should have a private email where they're trying to keep their private life and their professional life separate. But if they use their private life, their private email accounts, to conduct public business, those records are still subject to the Open Records Act. Why is that? It's because the Open Records Act goes back to that first slide where we looked at documents. The Open Records Act is not premised on the idea that it's necessarily has to be a government-owned computer. It's anything that is produced or received in the process of performing government services. And so, to give you an example, if a mayor was using a private email account to conduct public business, the courts would not have any hesitation to say that document is still subject to the Open Records Act. The hard part is basically keeping track of it. In other words, and so I do very much encourage, if you are seeing a government official, if you see an email or you hear about an email that it came from their private account, I would make an Open Records Act request specifically referencing that private account. That is not, there's nothing that puts that account off limits if they're using it for professional business.
One other thing we want of this is that sometimes I think public officials feel like if they're having another conversation with another public official and it's only two of them, it doesn't fall under the Open Records Act. But how would you address something like that?
Yeah, it definitely does. And so what is, and actually, the new law couldn't be clear on that subject. So the new law does basically say that exchange of email is not necessarily an open meeting, but it says it will be subject to the Open Records Act. So that should be helpful in that regard.
I have had somebody charge me the copying fee for records they emailed to me. Can they do that? It didn't make sense that they would charge you a copying fee for emailed records.
So presumably they probably emailed it to you in PDF. To get to the basis of her question, so everybody understands, is she received records by email that were likely in a PDF format. If you receive records electronically, electronic copies of records, you're not supposed to be charged this 10-cent fee. In other words, you're not getting a physical paper copy, you're just getting it electronically. But one thing to keep in mind is agencies are now allowed to charge for redaction. And so there are going to be situations where an agency said, we had to make a physical copy of that document in order to eliminate the portion that we had to redact. And so in order to make, you incurred some redaction costs. And so that we are passing those costs along to you. It is possible there could be costs in connection with even an electronic document in connection with redaction, but there shouldn't be otherwise.
But if they're charging me the 10 cent per page for a 10-page document, or, that you should resist that, or you could resist that?
Well, I think it would really come down to whether they're saying that was part of the, three copies in order to redact those three copies. So we're charging you that fee. One of the things that makes that answer complex is the portable document format from Adobe has gotten more and more sophisticated. You really don't even have to print out a document in order to redact it. You can just turn it into PDF and then redact it electronically. So, I think you have an argument that if they have that capability and it's the more modern versions of PDF, they should be doing it that way to comply with this idea of lowest possible cost.
And what we get frequently is we asked for four documents from the personnel file. They actually had to physically copy it and black it out, but then as a courtesy to us, they email it to us. You can expect to pay the per page charge for that, because they had to physically copy it. They drew it on a copier, scanned it, and emailed it to us just as a courtesy so we didn't have to go pick it up. But in order to black out the pages, they actually had to make
paper
copies.
But if there were no redactions?
If there are no redactions, you shouldn't be paying a per page cost for electronic copy.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Since redaction and search can be done electronically, even in the way you described, with a personnel record, I don't really understand the costs. I mean, you put in, the parameters for a search, it pulls up the emails that fit those parameters.
So, just so you understand, I don't agree. In other words, there is, actually searching email is fairly complex. And so it's there, and the person who's doing that time, it's spending that time, they are allowed to charge at the lowest, go back.
Well, I don't understand, I guess, the complexity issue then.
So you can't see the prorated hourly salary of the lowest paid qualified employee. Somebody's got to go conduct that search, and somebody who conducts that search has to have some confidence in how the email system works. And so that is a legitimate charge for them to pass along. And that's why there's no area where I encourage. So let's talk about email for a second. The new act specifically says email is available, but it also says, it also asks the requester, if possible, to provide the database you think the email is on, the identity of the people who are involved in the email, as much specificity as you can. Because frankly, this is a constant source of friction, but it is not, I do think there is an expectation in the public that email should be very easy to provide. And there is, the agencies are frequently struggling with having to, with frankly their email vendors saying, all right, we need this search, and that search is involving costs. So the more there can be a dialogue on that, the better, the easier it is to avoid basically a collision of expectations in that process. And I'm gonna move on, and just after this last question, just so we hit some of the exceptions too. Mm-hmm.
Is there a state record retention law that would say how long they must maintain anything from emails to anything else? Can they zap their emails every day and completely delete them from the system?
So that is an excellent question, and it is a source of controversy right now. In other words, there is a records retention law. Certainly every state agency and even every local agency is supposed to have a records retention schedule. And that's a worthwhile, if you're making a lot of Open Records Act requests to an agency, at some point asking for their records retention schedule is a worthwhile document to try and get your hands on. They're supposed to have a records retention schedule. Not every, I would think almost every state agency does, but I doubt every local agency does. But it's a worthwhile thing to ask for. That would lay out when records are supposed to be kept. Then the question becomes, are they supposed to keep email? There is some difference in opinion about how that is supposed to work. Our position is that the email is supposed to be retained. It's not the fact that it's email. It is supposed to be retained according to the schedule of the substance of that email. In other words, if this is an email about an agreement that is being made by the agency, it should be kept as long as correspondence is kept. But some agencies are taking the position that email is, we don't have any line for email in our records retention schedule, so we can eliminate it as frequently as we want. My suspicion is that process is going to get resolved, but it is, and there's no court decision on it at the moment. But I do think it is a question that the archives, State Archives Office, which basically runs the records, it's called the, what we're talking about is the Georgia Open Records Act. That is called the Georgia Records Act, which defines the retention schedules. It is now a violation of the Georgia Open Records Act request to destroy things in violation of the Georgia Records Act. So they are working together better, but the State Archives still needs to decide some of the issues with the Records Act.
All retention schedules are available on the Secretary of State's website for both government, state government, and local and county governments.
Great.
It's under the Archives tab.
Very good. So that's an easy place to find that as records, which could be worthwhile. I'm gonna touch on one more thing on payment of records, and then we're gonna take a look at some of the exceptions. And that's, I want everybody to understand one thing that is definitely new under the Act, and it gets at when you're gonna be responsible for costs, and when the agency can hold up copying records or getting records available. So. If a cost is to exceed $25 or other limits set by the requester, the agency may await approval by request before proceeding. So what does that mean? That means if you submit an Open Records Act request for a very small group of documents, and the cost that is going to be passed along to you is less than $25, the agency is not supposed to, it's supposed to give you an estimate, but it is not supposed to wait for you to get back in touch before proceeding. It is, there's an understanding that the agency should be proceeding with production of the records What led to this? A concern that agencies were basically slowing down the Open Records Act process by having a back and forth over these are the charges, are you prepared to pay? So if it's less than $25, $25 or less, then they're supposed to be moving forward with the process of getting your records, and you're going to be expected to pay the reasonable charges in connection with producing those records. If it's more than $25, then the agency can say, look, that's going to cost, they can send you an estimate saying it's more than $25. We have not taken any action to get your records. We are waiting for approval from you of this charge of $57. And so they can wait for your affirmative acknowledgement that that charge is okay, and then work on getting the records together. You can change the limit if you want. And frankly, law firms and organizations that make large estimates sometimes say, please proceed with production of the record, only notify me if it's going to exceed $100 or $250, if they know that there's going to be some cost escape. And so that's, you can actually change that number, but if you don't change it, it's going to be $25. If the cost is to exceed $500, the agency may insist on prepayment of costs prior to producing the records. I really don't think that's too surprising. In other words, at that amount of money, the government's going to say, we actually need you to provide the money before we produce those records. This is also important. If a requester has failed to pay previously, upfront payment can be required. So, frankly, government agencies were very concerned about abusive requests and proposed various language that would allow them to sort of take action directly against what they saw as abusive requests. I think the sponsor and the Attorney General saw that that really was not appropriate with the democratic spirit of the Open Records Act request. And so the conclusion was, we'll leave costs as a mechanism to try and for agencies to deal with situations where they feel like they're being asked to constantly produce records, but nobody's paying them. So if a requester has failed to pay previously, then an agency can say, can start requiring upfront payment before producing records. So I'm going to jump to, let me touch this, and then we're going to look at some of the exceptions. This is a very important new statement that was added to the Open Records Act request that I think have very positive benefits for access going forward. If an agency contracts with a private vendor, the arrangement shall not impede public record access. In other words, one of the things I mentioned is more and more records are being, especially as government becomes more digitally focused, more and more records are maintained by private vendors. So you submit an Open Records Act request, and you're told you can't have that because it's in this vendor is the person who actually does that work for us. That arrangement is clearly now, under the clear language of the law, not appropriate. The private vendor has to be complying and providing with the Open Records Act request. I would say the best government agencies have been including in their contracts with vendors that they were going to have obligations under the Open Records Act. That's now really required by the state law, and that's a new addition to the Open Records Act. So I want to touch on some of the exceptions to the Open Records Act, and we'll go a little bit longer, but not too much, because we want to turn to the Open Meetings Act. As with the old Open Records Act, sensitive private information is generally accepted out of the Open Records Act, so that's not surprising. Social Security number, bank account, medical records. Obviously, the government is a large employer. A lot of its employment records are private, and the government employees have a right to that privacy, so those are exempt. Two additions to under the new law, a cell phone or personal email, if that's contained in government records, then those, that too, can be removed from those records
Is that a personal cell phone or a government cell phone?
I think certainly the concept was your personal cell phone, but I actually, that's a very good question. I do not recall whether it's...
It doesn't specify. The thing here is, this part of the law is really written about, like, individuals' names. Like, if you go to a city council meeting and you sign up to get alerts for the city council, then you're, if you put down your cell number and your personal email, that kind of information is exempt. I don't think, you know, if you actually had a listing of assigned government employees and their assigned cell phone numbers, I don't think that would be interpreted that way.
I don't think so, but that's a good question. Employee protection applied to retirees. That was kind of a gap in the law. Exemptions. So this is an important issue. If you ever request electronic records, frequently agencies have said, hey, we can't provide those electronic records because buried within them are a few we suspect. There might be some government employees who have special rights, and so you can't get any of the records. It's now making clear the records have to identify the individuals as government employees. Some other exemptions. I'm going to go over one in particular that is new and that is changing the law a little bit. I actually don't think it's changing the law a lot. One of the exceptions that's always existed and really has to exist in an Open Records Act is information restricted by federal law. Traditionally, that has included medical, private medical records, HIPAA records. There is a law very much like HIPAA called FERPA. That is basically the Family and Educational Rights and Privacy Act, something like that. It is basically the federal law that protects all of our school records, all of our educational records. And there for some time, but the way FERPA works is if a government agency releases records, educational records that are identifiable about individual students or former students, if it does that, it potentially puts at risk its federal funding from the Department of Education. It was unclear for a long time, and there have been Georgia courts that said, we don't really see that as an exception to the Open Records Act. That's really a funding issue. Federal courts had taken a very different view and had criticized the Georgia court's perspective. The new law now makes clear that FERPA, educational records covered by FERPA, are an exception to our Open Records Act. So here are two of the most important exemptions that continue to be part of the law. But there's a clarification in the new law that is very important. So one of the things the old law and the new law continues to exempt is records of a personnel investigation until 10 days after presented to an agency for action. So what does that mean? An employee gets in trouble. The government agency conducts an investigation. The records of that investigation can be withheld from the public, even if there's an Open Records Act request for, hey, we want to see what were the results of the investigation. They can be withheld from the public for 10 days until after that investigation is essentially presented for action. Like, what does that mean? That sounds a little bizarre, but it actually makes a lot of sense. What it means is when that investigation is concluded and presented to an agency to take some kind of disciplinary measure, that agency has 10 days to basically deliberate, figure out what it wants to do, inform the employee, and proceed. It gives them a little opportunity to take action on the results of the investigation. But if that agency doesn't do anything, in other words, the 10 days lapses and that no action has been taken, then the view of the act is that at that point there's been an opportunity. We're not going to let people just sit on the results of an investigation forever. After 10 days, in response to an Open Records Act request, it does have to be released to the public.
So that's an internal disciplinary investigation. This is the record, this exception goes to the records of law enforcement or a regulatory agency, an agency that's got law enforcement-like powers. And what it allows law enforcement agencies to do is basically withhold their records from release to the public during an investigation or during a prosecution until the case is closed. It's not really surprising. In other words, while there's an ongoing investigation, law enforcement is allowed to keep their records, the law enforcement records they've generated as part of that investigation, away from the public. It doesn't mean they have to. They can make decisions about what they release. Obviously, government agencies, police agencies release sketches all the time and other information if it helps, if it facilitates the investigation. So one thing that was very important that the new law does, because I do think it's been a significant problem, is it emphasizes that this is a law enforcement exception. This is an exception that can be invoked by the GBI, by the Atlanta Police Department, by other law enforcement agencies. It can't be invoked by the target of an investigation. So if a City of Atlanta employee is under investigation for doing something possibly criminally wrong, the City of Atlanta is not supposed to be invoking this exception to try and protect all its records and try and prevent scrutiny of whether the city was aware of that conduct. It is an exception that's supposed to be invoked only by the law enforcement agencies themselves. So a few other exceptions. Trade secrets is, that's when a corporation says, hey, some of the information we are providing to government is in fact so, it's in fact something we keep secret and something that is so important to the way we do business, if our competitors were allowed access to it, it would do us a great deal of damage. Trade secrets were protected under the old law, they are protected under the new law, but the new law makes very clear that a corporation is really supposed to, when it submits those trade secrets to government, it's supposed to spell out in an affidavit that those are trade secrets. After the fact, it is not supposed to be coming in and saying, huh, now that we found out you got an Open Records Act request for them, we think they might be trade secrets. It is supposed to be accompanied by an affidavit. Property acquisition. So the records of a government agency when it is considering acquiring or disposing of land, in other words, selling land, can be withheld from the public until the deal is closed. Why is that? That is basically to prevent the Open Records Act from being used as a tool by for people that are trying to take advantage of the fact that the government is a big buyer and a big seller of land. And if they can find out in advance what land they're after, that would allow them to basically try and buy the land in advance of government and increase the price.
Mm-hmm. I think it may or may not also include a lease. And you know, this is a weakness in the new in the new law versus the old, because property can be sold, and there's an example, you know, probably right here in the Dunwoody area of a property being not purchased but sold without public approval or knowledge, and the excuse or whatever you want to call it was, well, it was inextricably intertwined with the acquisition of property, therefore it's covered under the open records. And this goes back to the previous law. It's not, but I think it's it has weakened the. This is one area that has been. That has been weakened. Just a personal opinion.
Right. So that issue has been a problem. In other words, if you have a large transaction in some form or a large project taking place by government, and one small component of it involves land in some form, some change to the rights to land, and so the government agency says,
we're trying to, as a result, the entire negotiations for the entire deal have to be kept secret. That, I agree, is a problem. It was a problem under the old law, it'd be a problem under the new law. But I also agree that that is an issue the courts are going to have to work out at some point. How far does the land protection extend?
You said property acquisition and selling. It's selling also, or?
Yes. So there's times where sales are going to be protected too.
Okay.
But one of the things to emphasize is the new law makes clear the vote must now be taken in public. And that is a big, the Georgia Court of Appeals had interpreted the old law as saying they could even vote in secret. In other words, there'd be no public component of the purchase of land. The new law now makes clear that vote needs to be taken in public. So I'm gonna end with this, and then, and Sean's gonna talk about the Open Meetings Act. these are probably two areas, it's a great way to end, two areas with a lot of friction that continue to exist in the Open Records Act under the old law and the new law. So attorney-client privilege records. One of the difficulties the General Assembly faced in looking at the new law is how do we handle the attorney-client privilege? The attorney-client, in other words, there's a feeling that government agencies do need to get the benefit of candid advice on certain matters without feeling like, well, if my attorney tells me that, my attorney actually tells me how much trouble I'm in, then that's going to become a public record, which is only going to make my trouble worse. The flip side of that is, rightfully, citizens can say, look, that attorney may represent you, the agency, but that attorney also represents us, the citizens served by that agency, so we should be able to know what the advice attorneys are rendering. The ultimate conclusion was that the attorney-client privilege continues to be an exception in the Open Records Act, but it spells out in a lot of words that will, I think, still be a lot of disputes over, that if a law firm is hired by an agency to do an investigation, something terrible happens. Sometimes when in the aftermath of that, an agency hires a law firm to conduct an investigation, the factual results of that, the factual findings of that investigation have to be released to the public once the possibility of litigation has passed. In other words, what you cannot do is simply hire a law firm, have it investigate, say, hey, we conducted a full investigation. We've concluded that there was no wrongdoing beyond this one bad apple. And so that matter's done. Well, we'd like to see the results of the law firm's investigation. No, that's attorney-client privilege. Now, the factual findings of that attorney-client privilege investigation have to be released to the public. It can't just be, hey, it was just that one bad apple, so we're okay. Same basic thing with attorney work product. These two, attorney work product and attorney-client privilege, are very similar exceptions, basically. But it's the same idea. Once there's not a threat of litigation, and in many cases there is not a threat of litigation, or the litigation is concluded, a settlement has been reached, then the public can see, well, what did that law firm find?
Let me kind of turn that around. So if there's a threat of litigation going on, then there is an exemption from someone requesting information about that investigation.
Exactly.
Okay.
So if there's still a threat of litigation, or there's still even a lawsuit, then the agency can invoke basically the full scope of the attorney-client privilege, just as though it was a corporation or an individual, which means you can't get access to the records. But a lot of times what has been a source of frustration is agencies have hired law firms conduct an investigation, law firms say it was just confined to that bad apple, the government agency pays some kind of settlement to those injured, So at that point, the threat of litigation has passed. The government's saying there really wasn't any systemic problem, but they won't release the only meaningful investigation that's ever been done into the issue. So the idea is to try and shake some of that loose. So that is the Open Records Act. We're now going to take a look at the Open Meetings Act. And if there's time at the end, we'll take some more questions.
Yeah, why don't we take a short break? Before you get up, let me introduce you to a few people in the audience. Tom Bennett just walked in. He's one of the people who founded the First Amendment Foundation in the early 90s. Another of my board members who helped start the foundation, Carolyn Carlson. These are two board members. I just point them out because they are the people who started this whole thing, and that's why we're sitting in this room today. Let's take 10 minutes. Sean will tell you where restrooms are, then we'll come back and do open meetings.
Because there's also another one down the hall or around to the left on the other side of the hall.
I just wanted to introduce myself.
We have about 20 minutes. We'll stay after and do questions, but I do want to make sure we get through the basic presentation in the next 20 minutes so that anybody who has other commitments and has to leave can make sure and get all of it. I'm Sean McIntosh. I'm the Deputy Managing Editor here at the paper, and my area is investigation, so I'm not a lawyer, but you can say we are power users of the law and quite familiar with it. The AJC also is probably the organization, I would imagine, that has done the most litigation around the Georgia laws, and so we feel a great deal of passion about this law and making sure it's a good one. We were pretty engaged in the fight this year. If you don't know the history of the passage of the law, the Attorney General really wanted to pass a new law. He campaigned on that. I think he was very well intentioned, but perhaps underestimated how hard it would be to get all the stakeholders on the same page when they started out. They drafted a law that I think really came mostly from cities and counties wanting changes. And to be perfectly honest, it would have been devastating had it passed. At that point, your First Amendment Foundation and the AJC and others down on us very heavily got very involved in helping draft the law. And so I think we came out with a pretty good result. A little background on it. The biggest thing that Owens wanted to do was change meetings. He's more concerned, I mean, he's equally concerned, I'm sure, about meetings and records. But he felt like the open meetings part of the law was being violated frequently. He comes out of local government, and he felt like it could be clearer, and he also felt like they could be tighter on what is a meeting. He started out with a very, very strong meeting position that essentially said if two or more people in an organization were meeting, that was a meeting. The cities and counties pushed back on that. One of the things that happened in that process was some new exemptions were written in because of the strongness of the law, and then there was pushback, the exemptions remained. So we have some new exemptions and meetings. I don't think they're terrible, but I think mostly they're reasonable, but you'll understand when you see that why there are some new exemptions in the law. Okay, so what is open? Pretty much same as the records law, the meetings law is very strong on this. Every kind of local and state meeting of a commission or an agency board is open, very, very strong across the local area on that, including committees. So committees and small groups of boards, a quorum of a committee is a meeting as well. There are some exceptions that have always been in the law for medical board committees relating to hospitals. added to the law was nonprofits that receive authority of their funds from taxpayers, that mimics the records law. So a nonprofit that's doing a lot of public business. What's not covered, no huge change here, except I talked some about the new exceptions, but the legislature, again, is not covered by the law. This is essentially an executive branch law. So really, courts are not covered by the law either, although courts are historically open. Court hearings and court deliberations are open by traditional law. You're not going to stand up in court and cite the Open Meetings Act as a way to get access to court or to court records. The new exemptions that are in are statewide original training meetings. This is when all the commissions go off together and have their convention. That's really important to them to be able to speak freely at those meetings with the legislative or executive branch in state or federal offices. This is when your city council goes down and meets with the governor or with the legislator. That's always been allowed to be closed, except for in the old law, they had to leave the jurisdiction in order to have a meeting. So Atlanta was really stuck. Everybody else got the right to go meet with their governor, but the city of Atlanta couldn't go meet with the governor because they didn't leave their jurisdiction to meet with the governor. So they've made that across the board now. Travel to a meeting. We can't get in the car and ride with two commissioners to the meeting and demand to hear what they're talking about, but they're not supposed to conduct business when they're traveling to a meeting. So, incidental meetings of the civic ceremonial functions. Again, if all of the county commission goes to a funeral for a longtime employee of the county, you know, we can't demand that that's a meeting and get notice of it and get the right to attend. But again, they should not be conducting business at those meetings. And then added new is mediation and lawsuit. If there's settlement discussions with a mediator, those can be closed. Again, the settlement has to be voted on in public, but the mediation itself can occur behind closed doors. Reasons for executive session, and I'll go through the process in a minute, but these are the reasons that a portion of a meeting can be closed. That a public meeting is held, but a portion of it is closed. I'm moving really fast, so if I'm not clear, y'all break in. The attorney-client discussions when the lawyer is giving advice to the board or commission. The personnel matters. These are specific personnel matters, not generalized personnel matters. So if they're talking about, gee, the budget's going to be cut next year, are we going to have cutbacks, that's a generalized personnel matter. That's not supposed to be closed. Are we going to fire Sean? That's allowed to be closed. This is a new one. I'm really concerned about it, and if you find it being used a lot, I'd like to hear from you because I'm afraid it's going to be abused. But if they're discussing records that are closed under the public records law, now they can go into executive session to discuss those. That in itself sounds fairly harmless. But what I'm a little bit afraid of is the way it will be used, because now if you go into executive session, you have to file an affidavit saying why, and you get a lot of specificity about that. I'm afraid that this may become sort of a generic, to discuss private records. Well, what kind of private records? Well, to discuss private records. So I would say if you see that being used a lot, I'd like to really hear from you about that. Real estate acquisition we talked about. In the new law, the final vote must be public and the terms as well. So it's not just, they can't just walk out and say, we're voting on the real estate acquisition. They need to say what they're voting on. This is really designed so that they can negotiate and put a contingency contract on in executive session, but then when the purchase is final, it's supposed to be in public. Same with settlement negotiations. They can have a settlement negotiation in executive session, talk with the board about we're going to pay this party that we injured this amount. The mediation is private. The discussion can be private, but the final vote, the amount, the terms of the settlement must be public. Interviews for executive heads of agencies. That's always been unclear in the old law. It happened a lot of times. We didn't often get in. That's really the top head of the agency. So you're talking about police chiefs, department heads, school superintendents, people like that. And those interviews can be private. All right, the process for an executive session, this is really important. There shouldn't just be closed meetings, okay? The way the law works, the meeting starts publicly, and then they go into executive session to discuss the confidential parts of the meeting, or the closed parts of the meeting. So they should have a meeting, there should be a motion to go in executive session, and a majority of the board or the commission has to vote to go into executive session. Under the new law, minutes have to be kept during executive session. You can't get at those, but the reason they have to be kept is that at some point there becomes a dispute, oh, they did a bunch of stuff in executive session they weren't supposed to, then those meetings are there so that a judge can look at them and see what was discussed. If during executive session, you know, they're there to get advice from an attorney about a particular lawsuit, say, but suddenly talk turns to something else, the chairman is supposed to rule that discussion out of order and say, stop talking about that. That's not the reason we're in executive session. And if the commissioner, the other commissioners or whoever continue to talk about that thing that's not an appropriate topic for executive session, the chairman is supposed to rule it out of order and adjourn the session. And I'll talk a little bit about the affidavit in a minute because that's really key. All votes, any and all votes, should be made in open session. Now, they can have some preliminary discussion, obviously, but when it's time to vote, made in public session. And then an affidavit has to be filed with the minutes saying, this is the reason for the executive session that we voted on, and we didn't talk about anything else. And I want to go back to this, and then I'll come back to questions. They now can make every member of the Board of Commission sign the affidavit. The chairman used to have to sign it, and the chairman, I think, sometimes felt not empowered to stop this, and then felt like he was on the hook for signing an affidavit saying we didn't talk about things we weren't supposed to. Now, if he wants to, he can say, I'd like everybody to sign the affidavit, so that I think, gives the chairman a little bit more enforcement. You had a question?
What if they check on the affidavit, acquisition of property, you know, legal, and what if they check, because DeKalb County has started doing that recently with respect to the county commission executive meetings. I mean, they could go down and check all those boxes, all those exemptions, and then just basically have a meeting discussing everything that they wanted to discuss. Is that legitimate or not?
It is legitimate to check more than one item on the affidavit, because you're not going to go into and out of executive session repeatedly during the meeting, although some agencies do, but they shouldn't be discussing stuff that's not, you know, allowed. But if they have two legal matters to discuss with their attorney, they can do both in the same executive
session. And a real estate, you know, and
something. Yeah. Well, I went to a meeting and I had the security tell me that I could not go into a open meeting, like an open school board meeting, because they were going to have an executive session. I said, well, I want to see the vote when they go into the executive session. And he said, well, no, you're not allowed in. So I started taking pictures. And he said, well, you can't even take pictures or videotape. And I was like, sir, you're talking to me. I know you can't do this. And of course, you know, I can't videotape, but when people do that, what can you do after that?
I would say to the security, what I would recommend a reporter do to say to the security person at that moment is, I need to speak to the attorney for the board, because the attorney knows that they have to vote in public to go into executive session. So if the security person has a misunderstanding of the law, that's, you know, that's not the end of the world, but I would ask to say, I'd like to speak to the chairman or the attorney, please, right away, because I believe you're about to cause them to violate the law, and I'm sure they wouldn't want you to do that.
So is this whole process exempting the General Assembly? Because I know with, you know, for example, the Senate Ethics Committee, they go into executive session and you never see them for 3 hours.
Yes.
But I mean, I was just wondering if this process is Is there a different process? Is there a
process? The General Assembly has none of this law applies to the General Assembly. They do have a set of rules, especially the Ethics Committee has a set of rules that they are required to abide by, and they say they do.
Because they do go into executive session, I just wasn't sure.
I know, and they do have a set of rules, and we have challenged them on that and gotten a little bit better cooperation out of them, but make sure you get that copy of the Ethics Committee's rules, and there are committee rules as well, but there are no penalties, right. So here. Yeah.
When during the open meeting, portion of the meeting, and they vote to go to executive session, do they have to somewhat disclose why they're going to executive session, or can they make a blanket statement, we're just going to executive session to talk about legal personnel or something else that exposure, do they need to indicate?
Unfortunately, it doesn't have to be very explicit. It has to cite the portion of the law,
okay,
which would be, you know, personnel matters, attorney-client privilege. They don't have to say attorney-client privilege because so-and-so is suing us.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's a question.
Yes.
Is there ever any time when those minutes that are filed ever become part of the public record?
No. The minutes of executive session, am I right?
So if the only way they would get in the public record is if somebody sued, said they had gone into executive session improperly, the court agreed, and at that point the court said, I'm making these minutes public. So otherwise, no. But it could happen as part of their lawsuit over the open meeting.
Okay, so if they didn't vote, for example, and just said, oh, we're going into executive session, then somebody could make the case that those are open records meetings because they didn't follow the proper procedure.
Right, but yes. It wouldn't happen, right, it'd take a court action.
It takes the judge. The minutes being kept in executive session so that if you sue, the court can look and say, oh, that was a violation. It also, if the court finds a violation, then any action they took in executive session is null and void.
So the head of that agency should be keeping those records sort of under lock and key somewhere in case they're needed at some point.
Right.
Yes.
That's one of the weaknesses in the new law because we recently filed for minutes of executive session, and they were released. And in one case, we have the minutes of 9 executive sessions, which we're alleging to have been in violation of the open records. And we wouldn't have been able to file the case if we didn't have the minutes of those executive sessions. So this is a major weakness, and perhaps something that needs to be looked at in the in the coming legislature.
Well, they didn't have minutes in the old law, so. Now that they keep minutes, I mean, it gives you some recourse to get them, but yeah, they're not.
I think they did. They did. Whether it was local jurisdictions, cities, or county, individual counties did have requirements that they would keep minutes.
Okay, and some of them may have kept them.
Right, but they weren't required to by state law by this act. I do think so. The real value of having minutes in executive session is if you believe something's gone wrong in executive session, you can file a lawsuit and ask the court to review those minutes.
Right,
the court,
in camera.
Right, yeah. Exactly.
John and Tom, uniquely here among 50 states is a curious anomaly that your last two good screen loads don't even apply in the 11 sole commissioner counties.
They can't have a meeting with themselves, can they?
Unless you can
wire
up their brains and get in there somehow, they can't meet with themselves.
Would we be covering the enforcement portion?
Yes, but we have 4 minutes, so we're going to go breathlessly fast, and then we'll stay. Don't worry, but I don't want anyone who has to leave to have to fill their mission. Okay, other key changes, the time to challenge a meeting has been extended. It used to be set, this is complicated, but it used to be a set thing. Now it's based on the time after the illegal activity has occurred. So it gives you 6 months after the illegal activity has occurred. It used to be that if you didn't find out about it until, 2 months and 28 days we're out of luck. Now you've got time. All votes taken in public, including property votes, and the law allows for teleconferencing in emergency, but the public has to be able to have access to that teleconference. So if they hold an emergency meeting because of a flood, whatever, they've got to make that available. We're having a little bit of struggle on that with some of the state agencies that have all met by teleconference, the regional ones, and they charge for every line that gets called in, and so they sort of balking at how many people can dial into those, and I think we'll see some rules making around that, but we'll get there. The enforcement and penalties are the same as for records, so let me go back to those. This is a very, very big deal in the law, very big important change, and Tom may want to jump in on this, but one of the things that happened in this legislation, and I want to call out Mary Margaret Oliver of Decatur as one of the people who was key to this, strengthened the enforcement provisions of the law considerably. The law used to have basically a standard of a criminal misdemeanor, so if you violated open records or open meetings, it was a criminal misdemeanor charge. Almost impossible to use, rarely ever got used. I think we looked and at one point found that, you know, getting the DA to actually arrest somebody under a criminal charge for violating open records, almost impossible. The standard was also very high. It was essentially knowingly and willfully violate the law. We have new enforcement that is now a civil penalty. And so you have civil remedies in addition to criminal remedies. And the civil remedies are a lower standard of proof, so it's negligently violating the terms of the law. So that's a big deal because it means you don't have to prove that they were deliberately doing it. If they say, for instance, I didn't know the law, and that would be negligence for a government agency not to know the law. The civil penalties are, of course, available to the Attorney General who can bring a civil action. But they're also available to you, anyone can go to court and seek civil remedies in the violation of the public records or the public meeting act. The fines also changed significantly. The fines used to be one fine of $500. Now, was it five or one? Five.
It was one for the Open Records Act and five for the Open Meetings Act.
100 for records. As the AG pointed out, he couldn't even drive down and you know, meet the mayor in some South Georgia places that were violating the law for less than $100, so it was really impossible to do. Now it is, I'm sorry, is there something coming in here?
Oh,
I know, but hold on, wait just a minute. What are you coming in for?
Was it James Shannon's
meeting? See if I can go to the next one. Thank you. Sorry, I didn't know we had any time. The fines are now $1,000 for the first violation and up to $2,500 for subsequent violations. That's a good deal. That's a big thing because it means if someone repeatedly violates over and over again, we have some ability to get sanctions over time. Good faith is a defense that's been in the law and remains in the law for criminal violations. So it also, there's a good faith defense in the law if they release records knowingly and intending to wrongly release records, there's a good faith defense for that. And then attorney fees remain in the law. So that's a big change in the enforcement. We haven't yet seen anybody bring about the civil enforcement, but I think when it happens, it'll send a pretty strong signal to agencies that that the standards are a little bit easier to prove and the ability to recover fines is far better. So with that, we'll go to questions, and since I'm not a lawyer, Tom will take a lot of it.
And hold on, let me just say for those of you who want to leave, I think I want to acknowledge one other person. This is Nydia Tisdale, who is filming. You may all who follow these issues know that this is the young lady who got thrown out of the Forsyth County Commission meeting improperly because City of Cumming, Forsyth County, because the mayor didn't necessarily believe, shall we say, in open meetings. So she'll be posting our session today and has allowed me to post it on our website, has going to post it on her own website. As I said earlier, I welcome $25 checks. Sorry to be a bully, but would love to have some. And thank you all for coming, and stay as long as you like. I'll be sitting right here, and my fabulous speakers are going to stay, I think, for a long time as well. Thank you.
Do you have membership on the site?
Yep, on the website. Donate. Yay. Thank you. Okay. Questions?
Obviously, this is grandfathered in, right? When it was passed, doesn't go back.
That's correct. So in other words, if activity took place before, what was that? What was the signatory date?
April 17th.
If it took place before April 17th of 2012, then it's going to be under the old law, not the new law. All right. Well, we'll be here individually if you have any individual questions for a few more minutes, but otherwise, thank you very much.
Thank you all.
Yeah, I'd love it.